So this lecture we're going to talk about more the time domain and spatial domain. Analysis. And I don't know, depending on how fast it goes, we will also start talking a little bit about the associated analysis, which would be in the frequency domain. And of course, if I say it's time domain, you can also, I will stop doing that, mentioning this specifically, but you can also, of course, think about spatial domain. And then in that case, you're talking usually about spatial frequencies. So that is, for instance, when you're doing a transformation in the frequency domain of a picture, and we deal with spatial frequency. The most important one in the time domain is signal averaging. And as you may or may not recall, I consider that one of the golden trio. But before I go into that, I will go into the other time domain analyses. And most of that you can read about a little bit more in section 4.8. Because the stuff we are discussing now is all going to be, you're all going to be able to find in chapter 4. There are a number of things that people typically do when they do time domain analysis. One of them is looking at, for instance, the power of your signal. And the power is typically, if you have a sampled signal, it's just a sum of squares. And you could compute that before or after demeaning it. So in that case, you would deal with the second moment or with the second central moment, as we discussed last time. There is a whole set of related parameters that's being used a lot in EEG analysis called the Hjorth parameters. These are all types of combinations that people in EEG analysis and also in sleep analysis use to characterize their signal by looking at the power of the signal, the power of its derivative, and the power of its second derivative. And that gives you a lot of information, pretty easy accessible information on your signal. Another important one is looking at zero crossings. If you look at the zero crossings of your signal, it's kind of a poor man's way of looking at the base frequency of your signal, because the overall slow fluctuations will cause the zero crossings in your signal. Very important one and very often applied is peak detection. And that's used for detecting, for instance, EKG, QRS complexes, or also spikes. Let's kind of look at an example that is in, if you start up MATLAB, it's in program 4.4. Then you will see the following. It's a signal that's pretty compressed with this red line. And so if you do the following, if you go with your mouse to this zoom symbol here, and you click on that, and you just zoom in on a little piece of the x-axis, then you will see something like this. And probably since you zoom in on a little bit of a different piece than I did, it may look a little bit different. But this is a pretty noisy signal where all these peaks are actually QRS complexes of the heart. And the dots are all my detections. So you can see here that my peak detection has worked pretty well. Every peak is being detected because every peak is marked by a red dot here. And that, in general, is another thing that I want to say, that if you do signal analysis, and students in my class and in my lab learn to appreciate this, is that you always want to make sure that whenever you have an algorithm that you test it, and that you test it again, and that you make sure that whenever you do detections that you verify that your detections are indeed correct and not spurious or not omitting any important events. If you ever, by the way, want to look at a program like that, you can see here that this is program 4_4. So if you right-click on this one, on this program, you can basically open it. And that would show you the text of this script, 4_4. And I'm just opening this to show you in large steps what I'm doing. The first block after the comments in green basically clear the data and set the states for the sample rate, the Nyquist frequency, the detection levels, etc. Then I load my ECG file in this load command here. And then I do some pre-processing by filtering it. And we're going to talk about filtering quite a bit in a few lectures. So for now, you can just accept that this is a filter procedure. And then the real thing that happens here is in this block, in this for and end block, where we just are looking at peaks. And the real crucial statement is here, this statement here, that says, the if statement here, if sub ECG FFI is larger than the one on the left and it is larger than the one on the right, then I consider that a maximum or a peak. And the rest of that loop is making sure that I'm not detecting peaks multiple times within one QRS complex. So I'm just giving it a little bit of a flush time, so to speak, that once I detect one, I skip a number of points to avoid detecting multiple ones in the single in that single area. So that's kind of how I detect these peaks. And you can use that for action potentials. You can use that for EKG. And it's a very easy way of detecting events in your signal. So far, peak detection. Sometimes, and especially people in spike train analysis, they have a tendency to not only detect the peaks, but they also often want to detect peaks with different amplitudes. So you want to have peaks within a certain that exceed a certain amplitude but are below a certain other amplitude. So that's called a window detection. And then there are a couple of time domain analysis that's pretty common, which is correlation, and we're going to talk about correlation also in a few lectures in much more detail than we do now. You could, of course, also look at templates, so you could do template matching. If you know what you're looking for, you can say, well, that's my template, and that's what I'm going to see. And you can make a little bit of an elastic in your criterion for template matching, or you can be very precise. And then last but not least, you see in many, many papers, you see also all kind of heuristic detection criteria, such as how sharp is the peak, how long is the duration of the peak, etc., etc. So that if you just look at your signal and say, well, this is kind of what characterizes the part that I would like to detect, then you make a heuristic detector and you go through your whole file and you see where these events take place. So these are all kind of, and certainly not not complete, but all kind of time domain or spatial domain analysis that you could apply to your data. So now let's get back to signal averaging, which is the main part of chapter 4. The idea there is that you are going to get a signal out of a very, very, very noisy measurement. And so you have some kind of a measurement. And that measurement contains a signal. And as you can see, your measurement has a sequence number, J. And every measurement has a number of points. And that number is symbolized by K. But every measurement has really a very significant amount of noise. Now, in order for signal averaging to work, there are a number of conditions that have to be satisfied. First of all, it's important that S and N are unrelated. So there is no relationship between your noise and your signal. The second one is that it's important that the timing of S is known. So, for instance, I know where S is, my signal, because I'm actually evoking it by a stimulation. Or I know where my signal is because it is related to an action potential that occurs. And so on, and so on. Then the other thing that's important is that S is consistent across trials. And the last one that we assume is that the noise is truly random. And it has a zero mean value. These are the four conditions. And I tell you already that in many cases that we are going to see and we are going to use for signal averaging, these conditions are somewhat violated. And that's the nice thing about signal averaging. It is pretty robust to a violation of these conditions. So if the noise is not exactly random, you will see there are ways of getting around that. If S is not really consistent across trials, you could consider the inconsistent part as noise again. And also that part will be basically taken out. If the timing of S, of course, is not entirely known, but as long as it doesn't jitter too much, then you could just kind of open up your averaging window and still capture it. So you can see that that you can basically get around if the these conditions are somewhat violated. So now let's look at the principle of this this whole procedure. Let's do a number of recordings. Let's say that we have my first measurement, x1, and then I repeat that measurement, x2, and I keep going, and then I get xj, and I keep going even until I get a number of measurements x capital N. So now what I am going to do is I am going to look at this these repeated measures. It's kind of an ensemble that we saw last time when we looked at noise, isn't it? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to just put a big line under it and just add them all up and divide by the number of trials n. So I just compute the average. And what I will get is something that will probably look like this a little bit. So you can see that if this is noise in each of these trials, then even when I do some averaging, there is a little bit of noise hanging around. It's residual noise. Now let's assume that somewhere in this signal, and I know that because at this point in time, I am providing a stimulus that I know that at some point in time, with a little bit of a delay, I will get this system to respond to the stimulus. And let's say that that thing is somewhere here. And as you can see, I now drew the signal that I'm evoking by the stimulus in red. The signal is really small relative to the ongoing noise. And so if I looked at a particular trace and I had not drawn this piece in red, that this was the signal here and there and there and there, you probably would not have seen this. I mean, it's difficult to see. Now, the nice thing happens. What is going to happen here? If I take, let's say, a particular point in time, doesn't really matter which time. You can see, since this is random noise at this point in time, here is going to be a little bit positive, here is going to be a little bit negative, here is positive again, here it's a little bit negative again. In other words, at any time, if I have enough trials, then this thing is going to kind of end up being very close to zero. The only part where that does not really happen is here, because this signal part is actually going to be there consistently. And so in the end, I'm going to kind of have here something that looks like this. And now all of a sudden, you can see that this signal, instead of being much smaller than the noise that surrounds it, now actually the signal is getting a little bit larger than the noise surrounding it. And that's the whole idea of signal averaging. And we have some kind of a mean, and I indicate that by the bar here above x, and I put an n here to indicate that it is the average of n trials, which is basically 1 over n, and then the sum of all my trials. Or if I want to use that part over there, I could rewrite this as the sum of this expression, a signal component and a noise component. And I'm writing it now as a consistent signal component and noise component. But just so you know, of course, in some cases, and in most cases, certainly in living systems, the signal component itself will also contain a little bit of noise. But you could say, well, in that case, I'm going to lump that noise here, or I'm going to treat that noise as a separate noise source. So now let's look at another example in MATLAB where we can see the effect of this signal averaging. And this is just, of course, a simulation. We'll do a real one in a little bit. If you do a program 4 underscore 1, sorry. You will see this figure. And again, this was a simulation of the averaging procedure. Here in green, you can see what the noisy trial would look like. And I didn't make it too noisy. As you can see, you can still see there is some kind of a sine wave buried in the noise. And then here in the blue trace is actually the signal uncontaminated with noise. And then the red trace is the signal that I recuperated using the signal averaging by measuring this signal multiple times. So you can see indeed, I start with the green signal or with the green recording where the signal is buried in noise, and I end up with a red signal where the signal is still somewhat noisy, but a lot less. And we get back to this example in a little bit in a little bit other context. We have been playing with our last lecture with expectations, and the expectation plays a big role in quantifying what is really happening during this process of averaging. When you average, basically you can formalize that by saying you're kind of determining the expectation of the mean value, isn't it? So, and we are interested also in the expectation of the squared values, then the normalized or the meaned ones, because that represents the noise. You really want to know in the end, well, what is the RMS of my signal versus the RMS of the residual noise? That is what you are after. And the expectation is a very nice mathematical way of dealing with that. The expectation is, in a way, a linear operator. And we will talk about what that means in a couple of future lectures. But it basically means that if you have an expectation of some constant value, it is a constant. If you have an expectation of the sum of two variables, you can write that as the expectation of one plus the expectation of the other. And this is clearly what we later will see, a linear property. And if you have, which is very important also, if you start to try to understand what is happening in this averaging process, the expectation of a product is actually the expectation of each separately, if and only if, which is written by an if with two f's, the x and y are independent. So if you, and these rules are actually not difficult to prove. If you're ever interested in that proof, I can show it to you. Then you can very easily formalize what is going on in this averaging process. And what's happening there is that you're really interested in what happens to the variance of your measurement, and in this case your average measurement, which is actually nothing else than the expectation of the measurements demeaned. And it is then easy to show. It's part of your homework to read through that. You can then find that basically the noise that you have in your average, the residual noise, as we called it, as a variance that is given by the sum of the variance that is potentially present in the signal. So if your signal is completely consistent, then this term is zero. The noise or the variance in the individual noise traces, and then divided by the number of trials that are in your average. Now that means just in English that the RMS, the root mean square in the noise, reduces by 1 over the square root of n, of course, because the RMS is the square root of your variance. And your estimate actually improves with the square root of n. So in order to get a 10 times better estimate, you need to do 100 recordings. That's kind of what that means. So just by doubling or tripling or quadrupling the number of measurements, you're not doubling or tripling or quadrupling your estimate. It goes with the square root. Okay, important question now. This is all nice, and it's easy to write down on the blackboard, but we are dealing with measurements. This is basically what we will have, a measurement. And I mean, we don't have the luxury where the signal is marked in red. We just have some measurement that's noisy. And then we get something that that's a bit noisy with something that seems to be happening there. And so in order to feel good about your procedure, you would like to know, what is my residual noise? So my question to you is, how would we get an idea about what residual noise really is in our result? Do you have any idea? Yes?
Subtract the signal from your average.
Yeah, so you say subtract the signal from your average, but how would you do that? Because we don't know what the signal is. It's a bit difficult, huh? Yeah. Well, of course, you could say, I do know that at least before my stimulus, there is no signal. So you could kind of look at the RMS value before you stimulate. You could certainly do that. You could say, well, I know that my stimulus starts here. So everything that happens here cannot contain any signal, because the system cannot predict the future. Huh? And so basically, I can use that. It's a bit tricky, though, because if you think about how these measurements are done, you're kind of repeating the stimulus. And so it could very well be that when you evoke something here, something of the response may enter a little bit into the next trial. So it's a bit risky to do that. But if you are stimulating far enough apart, that's reasonably safe. The other thing, and I don't think you will easily come up with that if you don't know that already, is that what we could do, what we did here, is that we just made an addition, isn't it? We added up the whole thing, and then we divided by the number of trials n. One thing we can do is that instead of addition, we can do this. Plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus. And so I'm going to alternate. And I'm going to add up, let's say, all the odd traces. and I'm going to subtract all the even traces. And now see what happens. Now the signal is going to cancel out itself in subsequent traces, because here it is present in the positive sense, and then I'm going to subtract it here. Same thing with this pair. And in that way, my signal is going to disappear. So your suggestion to subtract the signal can actually be done by doing this, by following this procedure. And the interesting thing is that for random noise, it really doesn't matter whether you add or subtract the traces, because these are series of random numbers. And if I add two series of random numbers, or if I subtract them, in the long run, if I do that often enough, it doesn't make any difference for the statistics of the noise. And so that means that I can create what we call a plus minus average. And the plus minus average really contains the residual noise. We now go back to that diagram that I just showed you. You were maybe wondering what is that black trace here. Well, the black trace is the plus minus average. So that gives you an idea how much noise there is still left in your average. If you add or subtract noise, it really does not matter. You can actually, there is a MATLAB file you can run, but we can also look at this figure here in the textbook. That is figure 4.3, where you can see two random time series. And you can look at the addition of the time series and the difference of the time series that are basically shown here. And you then have next to each of these, you have a histogram showing the statistical distribution of these time series. And you can see that these distributions are virtually identical. So taking advantage of this property, you can basically make your noise estimate. It's an important thing to do, because otherwise, certainly where things are a little bit dicey, you are really worrying about, well, is this really my signal, or is it really not? There is one other trick you can do if you want to install confidence in your result. And that is, for instance, if you can repeat your measurements a number of times, instead of doing an average of n, you can make an average of n divided by 2. And then you have two resulting averages. And if your signal, basically, when you superimpose these two, if your signal is exactly at the same position, that indicates also that, yeah, that is very likely a signal, because the fact that such a thing would show up randomly twice is very low. So these are all things that you really need to do if you want to make sure that your procedure is giving you the right result. Now let's talk about a few violations of our assumptions. because here I was drawing the noise more or less as a random signal with some large and fast fluctuations and going up and down. This is my best effort of drawing a random signal. But in some cases, as you know, and certainly when you do measurements, you know that your noise is actually looks something like this, 60 cycles. Well, this is not really random. And a lot of measurements that you have in electrophysiology contain these 60 cycles, or if you're in Europe, 50 cycles. And I often tell this story that when I worked in the private sector in the medical equipment business, they once shipped me to Geneva in Switzerland because people could not get rid of their 50 cycles. They really couldn't. And they had, at that time, they had also bought a Faraday cage to kind of shield for the 50 cycles. These Faraday cages are expensive. They're like $500,000 a piece. So they're expensive. And still, they really couldn't get rid of it. And I recall walking in, and it took me literally 10 seconds to see what the problem was. And so actually, I played it nice, and I pretended for 10 minutes that I didn't. But what actually happened is that they were recording this by stimulating these epochs exactly at 5 hertz. They were doing visual evoked responses, and they were doing this at 5 hertz. And you have to realize that in Europe they have 50 hertz hum. This is called hum. And so that means that if you do your first stimulus here, then the next stimulus will come exactly here 10 cycles later. And the next one will come exactly here 10 cycles later. Etc., etc., etc. So then the average technique is going to do exactly what it's designed to do. It's going to make very tiny signals easily visible. So although they didn't see any 50 cycles in their individual traces, because of the fact that they were just stimulating in an exact multiple of the 50 cycles, they were just enhancing their 50 cycles. So what did I do? Well, I did not suggest they build another Faraday cage of $500,000 around it. I just changed their rate from 5 to 5.1. And that was it. Because now the first stimulus will come here, and the next stimulus will come a little bit earlier, the next stimulus will come a little bit earlier, the next stimulus will come a little bit earlier. And by just picking different pieces as a starting point, you're just going to kind of cancel out your 50 cycles. And it's going to disappear.
How much did you charge them?
So that's one way of doing it. So if you have something like that and you say, hey, this is really weird, this is this regular frequency, think about 60 cycles, 50 cycles, think about frequencies that come from your recording equipment, maybe your stimulus isolator, maybe your power isolator. If you see something regular, then just change the rate at which you stimulate, and that might actually solve the problem. There is another way, of course, where you can solve this. It's actually a little more elegant, also from a biological perspective. You know what? If your signal is not random, make your sequence random. So in other words, instead of stimulating at a fixed rate, make your stimulation rate a little bit random. And in that case, you don't have a risk that you are going to systematically pick out a certain phase of whatever artifact there may be in your signal. So that's kind of what I meant. And I said, well, sometimes you can actually violate the rule that the noise is not random. If the noise is not random, basically you can get around it by changing your rate, or if nothing else, just make your stimulus sequence random. And then
basically it works again. This is this whole principle.
There is also a case where noise can actually help. Which is a bit counterintuitive, but I'll show you an example. Let's say that we, and now we're going to say that we want to sample an oscillation. So now this oscillation is not noise, this is something we want to sample. Let's say this is a high-frequency oscillation in the EEG that we want to sample. Now let's say that I want to sample this, and I'm going to exaggerate the example, with a 1-bit ADC. One-bit A to D converter. That means that in that case I have only two levels, isn't it? I have some kind of a threshold, and if the signal is above, it's going to be a 1, and if the signal is below, it's going to be a 0. It's not like that example that we had the first lecture where you have 3 bits. I have just 1 bit. It's just 0 or 1. It's almost like a neuron. It's either sub-threshold or it's firing. In that case, if I would sample this thing, I would get something that looks like this, isn't it? Provided that I put my zero level in the middle of this sine wave, and that would not work out well, because now the signal that I sample really doesn't look much like the signal that I'm trying to measure. Now I'm going to add noise. I'm just going to add a little bit of noise. Not too little, not too much, just the right amount of noise. And see what happens. In that case, instead of measuring this every time, the signal is going to be a little bit higher, it's going to be a little bit lower. And now the chance that this thing will be close to 1 will be related to the amplitude. Because if I add noise, the chance that this thing will be up will be higher here, for instance, than there. And if I repeat this again and again and again, the noise is just going to kind of smooth this thing out very nicely. I wrote, and we're going to do that in a minute, I wrote a little MATLAB routine simulating exactly this process. So I took the same signal that you just saw in the other example, where we computed the average. And now I am basically repeating the whole thing with in the same way, but now I pretend that I'm having a 1-bit A to D converter. And as you will see, and we're going to do that now, as you will see, I am still capable of getting a decent recording, a decent average. If you have not ran program 4.1 yet, you have to run that first because it uses the same data. And then you run program 4_3. And then it asks you if you did run it, and you just say yes. And here you see the result where I repeated the whole procedure with a one-bit A to D converter. And you can see that if you compare the red signal here, which is the result from the averaging procedure as we had previously, and now you see here the result with the one-bit A to D converter. You see it is a tiny bit noisier, but overall this signal has been kind of measured. We know now what that signal is, and we didn't need anything fancy. Just the one-bit A to D converter did it. Had I removed the noise here, what would I have gotten?
Square.
The square, exactly. So you can actually, you have program 4_3, you can, it's actually not a homework, but it would almost be a nice homework to just remove the noise in this example. And then you would, in that case, you would see that you would have a square wave instead of a sine wave. And so in this case, the noise really helped you to recover the real signal. And that is because with signal averaging, you take advantage of the statistical properties of the noise, which is, in this case, working in your advantage rather than in your disadvantage.
Quick question?
Yeah?
So this is with a threshold of 0.5, the A2.
You mean, yeah, right.
What would happen if you have a different threshold?
Yeah, if your threshold is wrong, or if your noise is too big or not big enough, the system doesn't work. So you have to be just in the right amount of in the right regime,
so to speak.
Yeah. Yes.
Is there a way to quantify the improvement in resolution from doing this?
Is there a way of quantifying the resolution? Yes, absolutely. You could do it theoretically. As a mathematician, you could go and work out the whole expectation. You can also do it experimentally by measuring the residual noise in this case, the residual noise in that case, and compare the RMSs. And since you know that your signal is the same, you would have an idea how much that is. And as a matter of fact, if you go into chapter 4, there is an example given where that is exactly done. Any more questions? Good. Then, to finish up this whole aspect of signal averaging, we are going to go and look at a number of practical examples. We have a couple of medical students in the class that are interested also in medical applications, and this has a lot of medical applications. There are what we call the evoked potentials. Used in a clinical environment, and there are different types of stimuli that you can give. For instance, there is the auditory evoked potential, or AEP, and sometimes people zoom in on the effects in the brainstem, so then it sometimes it's called the BAEP, or BEP. Usually you do that by giving a sound click, clearly audible sound click, say 90 dB or something like that, 90 decibel. And sometimes a little bit softer, but certainly not more than 90. And then you repeat that, certainly the brainstem evoked potential, since the brainstem is so deep, the signal is really small relative to the noise, so you need to do 2,000 repetitions in order to get a visible response. And it's often used for screening babies. It's always a big deal. Is the baby deaf or can the baby hear? Well, if you have a brainstem evoked response and you show clear arrival of the evoked response in the brain of an acoustic stimulation, you know at least that the system is working. The other one is in the visual system, visual evoked potential. I just mentioned that one in Geneva, Switzerland, where they actually use the checkerboard patterns to evoke visual stimulation. But sometimes people use flashes. That signal is much higher because it's in the occipital cortex, of course. So it's much more superficial, and you can basically deal with roughly with 200 repetitions. It's being used for a lot of screening. It used to be very popular to check multiple sclerosis. Nowadays, of course, with the MRI, usually people use MRI to do that analysis. But it still works. It's a good test. Somatosensory evoked potential. Since the response is a little bit smaller, usually it requires 500 repetitions. Here you stimulate the somatosensory system, so usually a nerve. It could be the median nerve very often. And on the wrist, the median nerve here. Or it could be the tibial nerve here at your foot. It's used for multiple things, but it's certainly very diagnostic diagnostically used in the OR and the ICU. And there is an example in the book that I give in the first chapter. I didn't focus on that when we were discussing it, but if you go to it's figure 1-3 on page 5. And this is actually the result of stimulation of the radial nerve. So it's not a median nerve, but it's the radial nerve. And if you look carefully, you can see that indeed there are two attempts superimposed. So that's what I was saying, that well, if you record something, you want to make sure that it is real what you're recording. And so in clinical situations, you usually record it two times or three times and then superimpose. There is also an what people call the oddball paradigm. It's a range of stimuli, and every now and then there is an oddball stimulus. So if you have a bunch of tones, it's like beep, 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 boop, beep, 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 boop. And the oddball stimulus is usually randomly given. And the oddball stimulus then, if you compare it with the response to the normal stimuli, shows a positive peak at 300 milliseconds, hence the name P300. Has been used typically a lot for Alzheimer's, and it also works well for finding abnormalities associated with psychosis. I must say that these are still being used, but more and more, it's more and more rare because a lot of imaging techniques right now are being used more frequently. I think the one that really survived very well is the brain acoustical evoked potential for the screening of babies and the SEP for OR and ICU monitoring. That's still being used really frequently. A very interesting one, and we're going to kind of look at that in a little bit. So the CNV a contingent negative variation can be measured in between two stimuli. And the protocol works as follows. You give somebody a warning stimulus, for instance, a tone. And then a little bit later, you give it a bunch of other stimuli, maybe a series of tones or a series of light flashes. It doesn't really matter. And the subject then has to push a button and turn the stimuli off. So the first warning stimulus basically activates the brain and makes the brain more or less in an anticipating state. And then as soon as the second stimulus starts, you push a button and you turn it off. And you do that a number of times. And then what you get is an increased negativity over the brain, probably representing the increased depolarization of the population as a whole. The alertness is increasing. And that we are going to look at in practice, and then you can see also a practical example of signal averaging. And that example is written down on page 67. And also the result is shown in figure 4.6. This time it's not a program, we do it by hand. So we start with the command clear to make sure that all variables are gone. We don't contaminate or make confusions. And then we are going to load the data. So let's give them load. And then the data file we are going to load is single trials, CNV. By the way, if you want to see what you just loaded, you can type whose, isn't it? I think I mentioned that earlier, but I'll repeat it. You can see that there is now a matrix of 500 by 32 by the name of single. Let's kind of look what that looks like, see what that looks like. We do a figure, and we plot this matrix, single. And now what you see is 32 repetitions of a CNV. I think you can probably see a little bit what the signal might be, but it's pretty noisy. So in order to see what's going on, we type hold to kind of make sure our picture stays what it is. And then we're going to plot the average on top of this. We do plot, and then we do sum of single. You have to give it an prime there in order to transpose the matrix, otherwise you make the sum in the wrong direction. So it's single, and then a little prime. We divide it by the number of trials, which was 32. And then we are going to plot it in black, which is indicated by the symbol K here. And we're going to make it plotted as pluses instead of dots or a line so that it's well visible. And of course, I lost my figure. Get rid of all the old ones. There it is. So now you can see that the original messy recording, very noisy, where we could kind of assume what the signal would look like, If we now take the average and reduce the noise, and this is only 32 trials, so it's not terrible. You can see now, indeed, there is a clear signal. That is a thick black line. This is actually where the auditory stimulus was. So this is the response to the primary stimulus. And here you see the negative variation. I'm sorry, electrophysiologists plot negative upwards instead of downwards. So this is the negative variation. And then here is the second stimulus, and that's where the stimulus is turned off. So this is the CNV recording. And here you see, these are really, these are actually recordings that I recorded on myself. So these are really, this is not simulated data, this is real recorded, a real recorded data set. Gives me a little bit of time, unless there are questions before we continue. Gives me a little bit of time to start introducing the frequency domain. Not unlikely that many of you have not thought about this previously when you record data. But whenever you have a time domain signal or a spatial domain signal, there's always an equivalent one in the frequency domain. And I think most of you are actually familiar with the frequency domain, even though you might think you're not. An example is, for instance, the light that we see. We all know that if you put light through a prism, you get different colors. And so the white light basically can be decomposed in different colors. Now that is, the white light is some kind of a compound effect of wavelengths or different frequencies. Another one that you are all familiar with is the power in the outlet, I think. If I asked you what is, what's the characteristic of that outlet, what would you say? What is that? What comes out of that? Do you know?
Alternating current,
yeah. Most of you would probably say it's 120 volts. And some of you that have a little more technical background would say, yeah, it's actually 60 cycles per second. That's what most of you would say, isn't it? It's 60 cycles and 120 volts. Actually, if you think about that, that's a frequency domain characteristic, because you did not tell me, oh, my signal that comes out of here is 120 times the sine wave of 2 pi 60 t. I think that's pretty unlikely that I would get that answer. I think it's more likely that you will tell me this than that you will tell me that. If you, by the way, if you had to give me the mathematical expression of this, could you do that? You actually can, but you may not know you can. What about this one? See, you see an application of the delta function. there is a delta function at 60 hertz, and the length or and the amplitude is 120. So you could also write this down mathematically. You can apply this the idea of frequency analysis, which is what we are going to talk about, to all kind of signals. But what we will start with is we're going to look at periodic signals. And you might think, oh, that's a severe limitation because a lot of signals are not really periodic, and that's absolutely true. But you know what? If I record a limited amount of signal, I can always pretend as if that signal is being repeated again and again and again and again. And so then it basically, I can pretend that it is periodic, because if I'm interested in this piece and I'm not so much interested in what happened before or thereafter, I can pretend that to be whatever that I want. So although I admit that looking at periodic signals presents a limitation, it doesn't have to be, in all practice, it doesn't have to be a very limiting one. Let us apply this idea to a periodic waveform. And in this chapter, we start with an example with program 5_1. Since I want to kind of get rid of all my previous plots, do not get confused. I'll type close all, so now all plots are gone. I'm going to run program 5_1. And that will give you two figures. One figure is in the time domain, it's on the left, and one figure that's in the frequency domain, that's on the right. And the idea is this. I have some kind of a signal, and let's say that this signal is, it's not entirely precise, but this signal represents a square wave. And if I decompose this square wave in a number of components, you can see that I can actually do that, this particular one, in five individual components. This would be the base frequency, and then I would have frequency a little bit higher, frequency a little bit higher, frequency a little bit higher, and you can see the higher the frequency, the lower the amplitude. And if I add up all these signals, I will actually, lo and behold, get this square wave. And if I would have been a little more precise, I could have added more high frequencies. And the more frequencies I was going to add, the more this thing is going to look like a real square wave. So this is what happens in the time domain. Now let's look at what that represents in the frequency domain. What I do here is I plot the amplitude against the frequency. And here you can see what we could see here already as well, is that this one is a low frequency with a high amplitude. The next one is a 3 times higher frequency with a lower amplitude. The next one is a 5 times higher frequency with an even lower amplitude, etc., etc. And so this represents exactly the same thing as that, but this is time domain, this is frequency domain. This, by the way, for people with a musical background, would be the bass tone and the overtones that you have. You would think that, because this is actually a type of Fourier analysis, you would think that Mr. Fourier would have figured this out because of music and tones, etc. But as a matter of fact, he worked on the Fourier transform to solve a problem of thermal conduction. So he came from a totally different background trying to solve a an equation, the heat equation, and came up with the Fourier transform. And later, of course, it's much easier to explain from music or light being decomposed in different wavelengths and frequencies. What we will do the next time is we are going to formalize this a little bit further. We are going to formalize this by looking into approximating periodic functions, or in this case, any periodic function, by a number of sine wave signals. And that's called a real Fourier series. It's not because there is also an unreal Fourier series, but it is because there is a complex one. And so that's, in a way, a fair warning. If you are rusty on complex numbers, you may want to quickly look at them. And, the next lecture, we will talk about the real Fourier series and the complex Fourier series, and then how that eventually translates into the Fourier transform that's being used in signal analysis. We will go from the real Fourier series to the complex one, and from the complex Fourier series to the Fourier transform. And the Fourier transform exists in continuous time, and that is when you do analysis, but it also consists in discrete time. That's what we use when we analyze digitized signals. And, of course, everybody nowadays can do Fourier analysis, because if you have MATLAB and you can type FFT, you can do Fourier analysis. But our goal is to really understand, for the next lecture then at least, is to understand what happens under the hood when you type FFT, and so that you know what the conditions are. Before we stop, any questions? If not, then we're done.